There's no, it's buried.
Okay, it's a little after 7 o'clock. We'll go ahead and start our caucus. Yeah, I want to do this real quick.
I'd like to see the solicitor here for this discussion.
All right, Mr. Smith, would you like to come up and tell us what's going on in your historical world there?
Nobody's taking notes, so I don't have to give my name and address.
Yes, we have to.
Good evening. Dave Smith, I'm here to give you an update, some news on the Ohio Historical Marker campaign that we've been on. You'll recall, I mentioned last time I was here, the deadlines used to be April 1st and October 1st. So we had originally planned to apply for one marker by April 1st. That would have been for the schoolhouse, Little Red Schoolhouse, and Olin Township on the opposite side. Then by October 1st, we're going to apply for one for Village Hall on one side, the Kennedy House, and the incorporation of Olin Village on the other side. Well, they changed the deadline dates to July the 1st only, just one day throughout the year. So we hustled a little bit. We got the one for the schoolhouse in March, and the one for Town Hall and Poland Village we did get in June. So we made the deadlines for both. Remind you again that the cost for the markers is $2,730. We always apply for the $750 grant available through the Ohio History Connection, they call themselves now, rather than the Ohio Historical Society, knowing that we probably would not get two grants. We were notified last week of our applications. I'll read you. We got two letters, actually, one for each application. For the marker regarding the Little Red Schoolhouse, Poland Township, congratulations. We're happy to report that the Marker Grant Committee of the Ohio History Connection's Local History Office selected your application as one of 10 to receive a grant of $750 in this round of applications. We received a total of 23 applications for grants, so competition was robust. So we did get the $750 for that marker. Regarding that marker, also, Larry Boffman, our president, and I attended a meeting of the Poland Township trustees and gave them information about our interest in applying for the marker, requested assistance for that, as well as a big issue we have at the Little Red Schoolhouse with the windows. That 1858-year-old building has the original windows, we figure, and they are deteriorating pretty badly. We had the building painted two years ago, and the painter had to use a lot of caulking around the windows just to kind of hold them together. Well, this year a lot of that caulking is coming loose with heat or whatever. So we are interested in replacing those windows. So we spoke at the Township Trustees meeting requesting assistance for paying for the marker that would go at the Little Red Schoolhouse and Poland Township, as well as the windows. The result was that we were given $3,000 to use as we saw fit for either or both causes. So we were very happy to receive that. Now, I don't know if you're aware, the township does receive some funds from Republic Services, the landfill, which they, I guess, are expected to use some of that for community purposes, and I think that's why we were able to sell them on that. And Mike Hare goes to a lot of the meetings, so he was right there next to see what was happening. So we're going to notify the Ohio Historic Connection that we will proceed with that marker. We do plan to dedicate that one in the spring of 2016. It does take some time to revise the text back and forth. They'll kind of massage the text and ask if it's all right and so forth back and forth. But then those markers are made in Marietta, an outfit named COS Studios, and it takes 3 or 4 months for them to actually construct the marker. So by the spring of 2016, we hope to dedicate that one. Now, regarding the marker for Village Hall, the Village of Poland, I can read a portion of the letter there. It says, your efforts to submit an application is greatly appreciated, and your topic is worthy of an Ohio historical marker. If you would like to proceed with your application and pay for the marker with your local community support, please contact us by September 30th. I went on in another part to say, the marker fact-checking and editing process can take approximately 6 months from the date of this letter because of the volume of applications approved. So I did notify Andy Baroff, the head of the Ohio History Collection, local history office, that we do intend to proceed with that marker also. The question now, of course, is paying for it. You'll recall that Larry Boffman and I appeared a few months ago and mentioned the possibility of the marker and hoping to get it approved, and that we were hoping council would be able to put it in the budget, probably for 2016, not this year, unless you have funds left over for this year. No marker will be produced until we pay for it. But if we pay for it early in 2016, we would expect to have it. Probably by June 25th or so, which is Celebrate Poland, we plan to dedicate it as part of Celebrate Poland this year. You know, also recognizing the 150th anniversary of the village. So I guess what I'm asking is if you can give us an estimate at some point soon, better than later, whether or not the village is able to contribute to this cost, then we would have a point to go from to ask other village organizations and individuals perhaps to chip in to meet the total cost of $2,730. If need be, we will borrow from our own treasury and then quickly pay ourselves back in the meantime. We did find out some interesting research. Larry Bachman, Ted Hoffman, and I worked on the village and town hall marker, Kennedy House. We actually did get the original minutes from the county commissioners where they approved a meeting to be held at the college, they called it, in Poland, for the residents to vote on incorporation. That was in August of 1866. We went up to the courthouse one day and spent several hours looking back through the deeds on this property and traced them clear back to Turhan Kirtland and Jonathan Fowler. One sold to the other and back and forth for this property. And then many other people through the years. Of course, the Stoddard name is on the marker out front. They operated a mill here. I could hardly believe this fact, though. Surprisingly, I'm 99% sure, I'd almost say 100, that one of the homeowners of this home served briefly as the mayor of a major metropolitan city before moving to Poland. A major metropolitan city before moving to Poland. This was way back, but pretty well confirmed that it's true. I'm not going to give you the name, I'll tease you. So we hope you'll keep the marker in mind as you deal with any other financial issues that you have. Regarding the windows at the schoolhouse, when we presented this need at the Township Trustees meeting for the renovation of the windows, and you know it's on the National Register of Historic Places, so you have to do everything kind of authentically. We've contracted with Ace Lumber once we have the funds to do the project. But when we talked about that at council, someone asked if we had approached the village about helping with that project also. We said, no, we haven't, but we'll mention it to you also. That total cost is around $10,000 to renovate the 8 double hung windows. We have applied, Larry Bachman has applied, I should say, for a grant from the Ohio History Connection for that also. That would cover 60% of the cost, and we do have an anonymous donation of $1,000, plus we think about 1,170 left from that 3,000 that the trustees gave us for the marker and the windows. So we're still short about $4,000 if we get the grant. If we don't get the grant, we're short a lot more, about $7,800. So again, you get a windfall or can find funds available, we would appreciate any donation to that cost also. Any questions?
So the cost for the village marker for $2,700?
$2,730, yep. That's two-sided. Cost a little more if you put different text on the opposite side, which we think it's two for one by doing it, so that's why we're doing it.
And you did not get a grant for that one?
No, we didn't.
Just for the little red school cross.
Right, and I think, I don't know, I'm just guessing, I didn't think we could get more than one anyhow. I think the reason we got a grant there is they are more likely to give a grant for an application that has some kind of state or national significance. And we use the theory about Poland Township kind of being the gateway for people coming from Pennsylvania into Ohio. So I think that might help that cost. Just as with the William McKinley marker, the fact that he became President of the United States, we got the grant for that. We didn't get the one for the village green in the graveyard, for example.
Okay, Dave, how much are the windows in the schoolhouse?
Total about $10,000.
Then the schoolhouse won't be authentic anymore, right?
Well, no, they're going to make the windows. They're going to use what they can from the present windows. Some of them even have that wavy glass in them, so we know they're old, if not the original. But they're going to make the windows to be more or less authentic, I guess you could say. I mean, he's got the details. They get information from the National Park Service about how you're supposed to do that. So that's why it's a little more expensive, I think, than putting vinyl windows in. Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. I have a question for him. Am I allowed to ask? I mean, it's on your behalf.
Sure, go ahead.
Well, I shouldn't say it's on your behalf. You didn't ask me to do it. But may I suggest since the Board of Education owns that building and you lease it, and you have 99 years on 25-25-24-year intervals, it's a capital improvement to an existing property, and I think you need to have a conversation. I don't want to look for more expense for the Board of Education, but it is our building.
That's true.
And therefore, you must not miss every opportunity.
Thank you for that input. We will be visiting a board meeting.
I cannot guarantee anything. I'm just one voice, but it makes sense.
You do own the building. We just lease it from you.
Right.
At least it's cheap, so that's good.
Yes, it is a bargain.
Yeah.
But also, we have a vested interest in the welfare of that structure.
Very good.
Appreciate it.
Thank you. Thank you, Ellen.
Thank you.
All right, you want to take this up at the next blooper meeting, or you want to discuss it today, or?
Whenever you want to do. I mean, obviously, we're not ready to set a budget for next year.
Right.
We do know that we, too, are going to get some money from Republic.
I was going to ask that. Do you get any money from
this
Republic?
This is going to be the first year.
Yeah, it's about time, I would say.
Yes.
It was priced right through here.
Yes, that's absolutely correct.
But we pursued it.
And the two of you, being both on Blooper and on the Finance Committee, provide a lot of insight into this.
Okay. I mean, I think it's a worthy cause. I don't know how everybody else feels about it, but it would be nice to see this building designated historically.
Mm-hmm.
Whether we can come up with money for the windows, I think it's going to be a bit of an issue. But then, you know, I don't want to speak too early not seeing numbers, because, you know, I'm a numbers person.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, until we know how we end the year, and if there's, you know, going to be some extra revenue that we could use, if you want to use it for that purpose, if everybody agrees to that. But think it over. You know, we're going to have $5,000 coming. I know you have some inclination to use some of that for some safety issue in the forest. I think, if I understood you correctly, Joe. So, you know, it's not like we don't have other things that we can spend money on. There's no question about that.
Well, the forest, the potential for income is there in another area. And also, Foundation met last week. I don't know, I have no idea what they may have come up with, but the foundation certainly needs to put some money into that. I mean, that's what they're there for. So I think the forest has opportunities to fend for themselves in other ways. Not to say that we shouldn't either, but these are opportunities I think we need to participate in.
This is not a large amount of money.
No, it's
not. I mean,
not.
At least not for the marker itself. Now, yeah. You know, the windows, if, you know, how you feel about that, but...
I hate to take too long because these get, you know, they're waiting. I mean, these are projects that are on the move, so we can't even hang it too long.
How soon do you need a commitment, even if we can't keep
the money? A commitment would be great within the next month or so. So
okay.
If we knew how much, if any, was coming from council, then we could know whether or not we need to go out to other donors and how much they ask for the marker.
Either or, you're still going to order the marker to be ready for the
year. Yeah, if you gave us nothing, yeah. Which I hope doesn't happen, right. We would just beat the bushes for Celebrate Holden Streetscapes, Rotary
right.
Club, anybody
okay.
You can get hold of. The William McKinley marker at the bottom says Holden Community Organizations. Mm-hmm. Not to entice you, but any donor of a large amount gets their name put on the marker also, because only three or four names. So.
It's our building.
Yes.
We're responsible for the village, which is going to be the two sides of that thing. We need to heavily participate.
I'm willing to say, as Chair of Finance, that yes, we'll put $2,730 down for the marker, but I don't know how everybody else feels. We don't have the marker tonight. So think about it, everyone.
Well, we all think about what Linda just suggested.
Well, I think we got to wait until next year. It's year end. How we do it.
We can't wait for the year. They can't wait for the year end.
Well, I'm just saying, maybe we can't commit to something without
would you like to talk about it at the next finance meeting?
Sure.
Okay, because we're due for a finance meeting on September 14th.
Yeah.
We can discuss that.
What do you think, Chris?
Bring it back to the rest.
Yeah, I think to at least give a donation of at least $1,000.
I think we should at least do the...
Split it in half, hopefully.
Wait, are we after two markers, Dave?
No.
For the schoolhouse and one here?
Schoolhouse is taken care of.
I was here. I would like to see this.
No, it's not here, but it's being...
Okay, but I mean, at least, well, let's start with $1,000.
Where's the other marker?
You mean the schoolhouse?
That's taken care of.
Yes, between the grant that we got, we had a small individual donation, and what the township trustees gave us, we can cover the cost of the schoolhouse
okay.
or the township marker.
Okay. Now, what are you after now?
$2,730 for the marker that designates Colin Village
okay.
and Town Hall. Well, I remind you, too, the Hein Fund paid the total cost for the Village Green and Village Graveyard and Paul and Presbyterian Church marker.
I'd be more inclined to be in favor of paying for the marker and maybe a little stipend for the windows, just to say we participated.
What was the total cost on the windows for the fall?
Total cost is about $10,000, but we're applying for a grant. We had a donation of $1,000, and we have about $1,100 left over from what the trustees gave us. You know, part of it's going for the marker for the schoolhouse. We only needed 2730. So we're going to need about $7,000 more to finish the project.
And as Eleanor stated, it is the property of the school, so you would think they'd participate heavily.
Yeah, let's see what they say. I mean, it's their school.
Well, they're two different issues. The marker and the windows.
Yeah, we're basically talking about this building.
Yeah.
We're not
yeah.
talking about donating for the schoolhouse.
Right.
We're talking about this building.
Right.
So everybody give it some thought. We'll have our meeting. Finance. Unless you want to bring a motion.
When do you? Pardon me?
Unless you want to bring a motion, then we'll vote on it.
I think we
should.
No. I think we should think about it at the finance committee meeting. We have one on the 14th. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about it then.
Okay.
May I ask, was the donor a Republic?
You mean through the township? Yes.
Yeah, through the township. That's
yes.
what I figured. Yeah.
Well, no, the $1,000 donation for the windows was an individual.
Yeah.
Not them.
I don't even know who it was.
Oh, that's all.
An individual.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. The last thing is appointment of deputy clerk of court. We've talked about this before many times, and Paula still thinks she needs to do this. She's working on her notary. I know that she's a Jim took her downtown or something to get the paperwork started.
No.
She already has one.
Oh, she already has it? She got to renew
it?
Right. Because I wrote up a $50 check and she already has a receipt back.
Okay, good.
So she's been renewed.
And this came about, and Anthony knows a little bit about it with us and stuff, rather than send it to Struthers, she would sign off. And so what are your feelings on this?
And I was in conversation with Linda today, and I think Nick, at one point or another, I'm getting a little confused, but she had been signing for the past so many years as notary, is that correct? Not as a deputy clerk. So if she was able to sign as a notary, and now she's a notary again, doesn't that take care of
there's something that came out that's the only people allowed to sign is like there's a small window of like three or four titles, which this is one. It doesn't really give her any power, just a name.
But we do not have clerk anymore.
Yeah, she used to be a deputy clerk.
Right, we do not have a court anymore. We have a violations bureau. I don't know.
Can give it another name, maybe.
But
will that name be sufficient for what she needs to do? It'd be nice to know. It'd be nice to know the details.
Mm-hmm.
What function that she does requires what title? I'm still unclear about that.
Hey, Tim, whenever you say that, the titles are only so many, what are you referring to? Is there like a...
Someone is allowed to sign certain documents, like the first SODIs or whatever they are. There's certain people that can sign, like, you know, that are basically process them or whatever the word is. And there's a small, she read, and mayor was even one of them. There's a couple titles that were allowed to do that.
And this is from the BMB that they're...
I believe so, yes. I'll text her and see.
Yeah, because I was actually, I met with the regional director of the BMB today on a juvenile matter. And then I got back to court and I got questions about this. And I'm like, I felt stupid calling her back up and saying, hey.
She always calls me the next day, did you pass us? And no, did you pass it? No.
Yeah. Kathy Pritchard is her name. She was in town. She was the regional director. She was in town today, actually, to meet me because I'm doing a presentation for the BMB.
All right, so this is...
So, but we were talking about juvenile law.
This is back from July 22nd. The council passed a motion last evening to name me deputy clerk of court so I can sign suspension forms for OVI arrests.
Without
being a notary. So now she is a notary.
Yeah.
I don't know if you have to be both or just one.
But what we're trying to figure out is what power does she need for OVI arrests? That's the question.
Yes.
A lot of power. A notary can't do that.
But she was doing that before.
She's been doing it, right?
She'd be a deputy clerk.
She was doing it before.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
but
not just as a notary.
But as a notary.
No, well,
yes, as a notary.
As a notary. But before that, she was a deputy clerk.
No, she has never been.
Yes, she was.
No, she has never ever had that title. What?
When we had the court?
She was never given that title. Her title, and still is, the most current one, administrative assistant for the village.
Yes.
That's her title.
But what does that allow her to do?
That's the question. So what I'm going to do tomorrow, Mr. Major, is I'm going to call the regional director of the BMV and say, what title does our clerk or someone need to sign OVI arrests, you know, sent out? And then whatever they tell me, then I'll know, do they have to be deputy clerk? Can they just be a notary? What power do they need? And then I'll...
She should be deputy clerk of court or something, because Mark's deputy clerk. Two deputy clerks, obviously.
Yeah.
To be curbed for violations bureau, whatever we call it.
And there's got to be something because we're not the only town or village in Ohio that doesn't have a mayor's court in that kind of thing. So other entities are doing it. What are they doing? And what do we have to do to follow it? I'll find out tomorrow.
Do you know anybody else who's just a violations bureau that I could call and ask how they handle it?
I was going to say the Middletown, but they have
Court.
Yeah, not off the top of my head. I can look.
You were just the lucky one that got picked on for that particular bunch of lawsuits that went around the state.
Yep.
7:30.
Why don't you say the pledge of
allegiance?
Correct.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Roll call of members.
Oh, you too. Okay. Mark, Mr. Kostet? He's not here. Mr. Donovan?
Here.
Attorney Limmer?
Here.
Mr. Major?
Here.
Mrs. Cernick?
Here.
And Mrs. Yash is here. Make a motion to excuse Mark Cassette.
Second. All in favor?
Okay.
Any opposed?
Wait, you got the Mark Maroch.
Oh, yeah, Mark Maroch.
Oh, yeah.
And make a motion to excuse Mark.
Second by
Joe. Off check.
That's a question. Second by Joe. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
Slow.
Okay. Acceptance of minutes from previous council meeting.
I'd like to move that we hold these over until the next meeting for an error on motions, ordinances, and resolutions. Mrs. Yash made a motion for the adoption of the resolution. B and C, actually, should be reversed here. B We should have a motion to waive the three readings to pass by emergency first, and then the actual resolution itself second. So those two things just need to be fixed.
All right, notification of meetings and events to the public and news media. Blooper.
Blooper will be before the next council meeting at 6:30.
Finance?
Finance will meet on September 14th at 6:30 p.m.
Legislation?
Traffic schedule.
Police?
Police, our next scheduled meeting is not until October, which would be October 6th at 6:30.
Streets?
Okay, I'll take that. It's 6:30 before our next council meeting,
which would be the 15th.
Boards, ARB.
As always, first Thursday of the month, 7 p.m., Village Hall.
Planning.
Planning will be September 16th, 7 o'clock, Village Hall.
Board of Zoning Appeals.
Nothing scheduled.
Western Reserve Fire District.
Western Reserve Fire District will meet Wednesday, September 9th at 7:30.
Force Board.
Fourth Tuesday at 7:30.
September
22nd. 22nd, all right. And Heinemann Memorial.
It'll be September 17th at 9 a.m.
All right, here's Paula's response for the mayor. Sent in my notary paper. When it comes back, I have to go back downtown and register with the clerk of courts. Only then will I be current. Notary or deputy clerk can't sign ALS forms for OBI. BMB lady said judge, magistrate, or clerk can sign suspension forms for failing to pay tickets, and the release is when paid. She felt that included deputy clerks. So it sounds like she's notarized, she can do it.
She said her notary is in process, it's not voice.
When it comes back, I have to go back downtown and register with the clerk, of course. Only then will it be current. So notary or deputy clerk can sign ALS forms for OBI.
She can do it as notary.
But she's not notary right now.
But she will be sure. That's how she's been doing it all along.
Backup, whatever you guys want to do. Think about it.
I have a friend, actually. I looked up other violation bureau, and Franklin County has one.
Deputy clerk?
They have a violation bureau. And my friend used to work at juvenile court, worked for the clerk down there.
Okay.
I'm sending her a message asking her if notaries can do it as well. So I'll confirm that with her. So I believe we can use her notary to do it, but then if you want that extra layer of, down in Franklin County, she's going to be a clerk as well, because they have not only a violation bureau, but they have courts down there. So we're not going to have that. We're going to have the issue that they don't have, which is we don't have a court to do.
She could be called deputy clerk of the violation bureau instead of court. I
would seem more accurate.
Yeah.
There is such a thing.
Yeah, but is that valid for right. that function?
Can we make up a title on
well,
our own?
No. As I'm thinking about it, you could probably just call her deputy clerk. Not in a court or not in a violations agreement, just deputy clerk.
Is that valid for that function, though?
Sounds like under the ordinance it is.
So what about with that? So the marketing business did the same thing, too, then, because he's deputy clerk.
Yeah. I think so.
I've been doing deputy clerk things for 28 years. What's the problem now? It's not a problem. I'm just trying to get clarification.
We don't have a court. That's what the problem is that I see. I mean, do you see that as being an issue? If we get anything challenged in court again, that we're saying that we have the court, when we were told the court is dissolved, that's what happened in our lawsuit.
Thought about that when you said that today, and I just went on the assumption that we were calling, in my mind it came up as deputy clerk of court, but if we just call her deputy clerk, then I think, there's no fraud, there's no misinterpretation. She's a deputy clerk of the Violations Bureau, but I don't think we need to be that specific. But she is the one who is signing off for the village on these suspensions, as she's a a representative of the Village of Poland. And that's all I think we're really doing, is saying that she's our representative for the BMV on these matters. And I think in that regard, I think it'd be okay.
That makes sense. Just deputy clerk.
I'm gonna send this message as well, but I think that would be fine. Yeah. But what I would do is I would call the director tomorrow and ask her for opinion as well. But we could do it one of two ways. I don't know if there's anything pressing, but you know, you could either name her deputy clerk tonight and then know that she has a notary covered, or she'll have a notary, I imagine, in a week or so, and at the next meeting talk about whether or not we name her deputy clerk.
She's definitely a friend of mine.
Well, like I said, the deputy clerk designation, in my mind, is the link that the BMV needs to do what they need to do about OVI suspensions and arrests. So all that, all she's doing by that title is saying that council is certifying her as the person who's the contact or the conduit with the BMV. So not just anyone can sign a form. This is the person that Village Council designated as the person who is verifying these, signing off on them, and then sending them down.
Let's make this simple. Should we make a motion for her to be...
Anthony, was your interpretation, though, of what she said in that email, it sounded to me like it could be either or. She could either have a deputy clerk of court or a notary. Either way, she was able to do the things that she has to do. Because she was doing them before.
It sounded to me like it was either way, but,
right.
But I don't, you know, I don't want to rely on her interpretation. I'd rather get the head person, you know, from
right.
the state.
Okay, then we won't make a motion tonight.
I think wait.
Okay. Thank you. All
right. Report from the mayor. A couple things. Bands, tag days coming up. September 19th, Saturday. Let's give time. I think it usually starts around 10 o'clock. So that's how they made your funding for their band stuff. There is a commissioner's meeting that's going to be here October 6th before first council meeting in October at 5 p.m. So if anyone wants to come see that.
What day is that?
October 6th at 5 p.m. at Village Hall.
And it's for county commissioners?
County commissioners, right. Yeah. 5 to 6. Okay.
Hey, wait, why did they come? I thought they always came to a council meeting.
Well, they're having their own meeting here. They like to go different
oh,
places.
Oh, they're going
to
have
yeah,
more,
yeah.
Than, more than...
A commissioner's meeting. Yeah, all of them will be here.
Yeah. Okay, interesting.
I have a... last time we talked about... We talked to Daniel Bartlett from the Forest Service, and I got back to him and sort of asked if he would help us out with the woods and give some recommendations. He sent me back an email. He had like 7 different topics that he wanted to know how we felt about certain things. So I'm going to pass these out to everybody. And Eleanor was kind enough to take this to the Forest Board and sort of throw them out there, and she made a consensus of what everyone felt. And those topics were wildlife, water/wetlands, reforestation, invasive plants, aesthetics, timber production, and recreation. And he said, by knowing how we felt about these, we can help him better to prepare a plan of action, what he thinks we should do. So she just handed this to me tonight. I appreciate that. And I will give this to Mr. Bartlett. And anything else he needs will help along the way. And then the last thing, I don't know if anyone heard our illustrious solicitor on the radio, but he did a good job.
Yes.
Didn't talk about anyone else but himself.
Would you give us an update? What was
he? He talked about the guns in the forest. And what was the other thing?
The trees.
Trees, yeah.
Trees. Yeah. And what program was this?
This is Dan Rivers in the morning.
KBM.
And the overwhelming consensus of all the people that called in was cut down the trees and get the money. That's what
yeah.
That's what I heard.
The one thing I did want to say, I met Dan at a party that Saturday night, and his wife actually saw me in public and said, I saw you, what were you talking about? The trees, and then Dan overheard and said, you should come on the show and clarify that. And I did want to talk about trees a bit, but I want to talk about the guns more importantly. So I wanted people to know that Poland Village Council did not okay guns to be in the Poland woods.
Right.
And I think some people actually thought that.
They did.
That you guys passed an ordinance that says okay for guns to be in the woods. I said that wasn't what Poland Village Council wanted to do, but I recommended that they do that based upon the law, which, agree with it or not, is the law. And That's why I want to coordinate this, so clarify that more.
But he did a good job, very well spoken.
Yes, he did.
Hate to say it, but he did good.
That's it for me. Motion to approve the mayor's report.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Report from fiscal officer.
Okay, I'm circulating around a list of bills to be paid. And the other thing is you have in front of you a copy of a resolution. Anthony, do you want to go over this?
Sure. You want me to do it now?
Yeah, it makes sense.
Okay. I got a call from the prosecutor's office last week, and they said that there was an issue that the election board had with our levy language, that it was contradictory. One part said commencing in 2015, and one part said commencing in 2016, or something along that effect. They weren't sure of the year that we wanted the levy to kick in. So they said, and at first I was worried that that would kick it from the ballot, but they said no, it would not kick it from the ballot, but we needed to clarify what the intent of the Poland Village Council was. So I talked to Nick, and he put together a resolution that clarified, which I sent down to Don Durkin and Lynette Stratford, who are the civil prosecutor, the heads of the department. They got back to me today. Was it today?
Yes.
Yeah, it was this morning. Yeah, and they said that it was good, but they wanted something clarifying that resolution by council, which I thought was, oh my goodness, how much clarifying do we do? So I wrote this resolution, which I believe clarified the resolution that we also sent down, which stated the time that we wanted the levy to be collected and when we want the levy to be implemented. Sent it down to the prosecutors. They made a couple changes, which Nick put on the resolution here. And now there will be no problems with the elections board as to the language they put on the ballot and as to when Poland can collect the tax and when Poland can spend the tax money. Collecting next year, spending in 2017. The other way would have been collecting it this year, because they're still collecting 2014, but collecting this year's money and starting to spend it next year, which was not what we intended to do. So this clarifies what was clarified by the other resolution, which clarified which was not clear by the last resolution. Long and short of it is, we're good to go now.
And that's it for me. End of report.
Well, one thing they found is things would be paid. What's Cleveland Tank and Supply? What was that?
That was the gas tank with the big truck rust.
Pardon me?
Cleveland
Tank and Supply.
Yeah.
The gas tank for the big truck.
Fuel tank for that F-650, one of our bigger plot trucks. From the way it sits, it's a saddle tank down underneath the truck, and from all the plow and snow and the salt, the tank brought it out.
Motion to approve the finance report.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Since we've been the city administrator.
Nothing at this time.
Question. Last week, we had somebody come in, they talked about the tree and the manor that needed to be removed. You were going to look into it?
Yeah, so what I did, at that time, here at the meeting, I immediately sent a text message over to our tree commissioner, James Bramer, in asking him to inspect these trees on behalf of the mayor. And he did report back to us, and I forward that along to the mayor. Give me a second, unless you have it faster.
He said that 38 Poland Manor, dead ash tree needs removed. It appears to be on the street side of the marker pit. And 45 Poland Manor, dead elm needs removed. Ownership unknown. So 38 looks like it's ours for sure. And 45, not for sure. Which one's the bigger one? Which one's the one around the woods entrance?
The one she talked about was 38, right?
But that's over by the entrance.
Yeah, that's
over
the entrance of the
Wheeler.
The other one's by your house almost, right?
No, 38. But she's at the wrong thing. because it's by the entrance.
Yeah.
That's by our house.
But there's another one by you, like right where the woods end almost before you get to your driveway. There's one there too.
There is one.
Yeah.
The one I'm thinking of is right at the entrance, the Weaver entrance.
Right.
And there's a walking, it's right on the walking path going in there.
I think that's the one she meant.
It's got to come down quickly. Because there's a lot of foot traffic there.
Do we have our bucket truck yet?
Yep. Yes, we do.
It's a pretty big tree.
Did we get that on our insurance rest?
I don't know that. Okay,
we need to know. We need to know that that's done.
I'll call and do updates on the insurance and make sure everything's caught up the way it should be.
Is that a thing you guys can do, take down a tree? It's a pretty big tree.
I'll look at it.
You're right by Mangy's old house, or you
have to... Yep, I know exactly what each one is. You've got to do something with this one out here, too.
How tall is that bucket truck up?
This one's a big one. Yeah, this is a big tree.
Okay. Now, first time you find out on that.
It's all rotted out, and it's falling apart before it falls and takes out two other trees.
I've already contracted the... Take this one out. Maybe we can get do that at the same time. Get an estimate on it.
You didn't have anybody who was giving us an estimate on that.
Nope.
I'll get Victor on that. Yeah, it's a big tree. Inside's all of them. It's all a matter of time.
Okay. Where's that one at?
Right out here.
Who are you going to have to take a look at?
Victor Vito's name. Was a tree removal. He did this work over here, stretching over here last year. He took down trees for me. He does trees. That's his business. And stretching. I'll get an estimate.
Right. Village of Poland is keeping a lot of tree people fluttering everywhere. Every week there's a tree coming down.
Seems like this whole meeting's been a report from solicitor.
Well, first, thanks to Nick, because I could not have gotten a resolution without his help. I got a call from someone who lives in, I think, New York. No, not New York. They're moving back here. Diorio, I believe, is her last name. But they own property over here by the bend in the stream, and it's being affected by the riparian setback that they want to sell the property. But they can't because they cannot build anything. And she asked what the process was. She talked to you, I believe,
she
as well.
She's on the council.
Oh, okay. So I told her the process would be a variance that she'd have to go through and that we'd be willing to work with her on it. And that even if the owners, the people that wanted to buy the property, they wanted to do something where they came in and asked for the variance through Angela, I think that's her name, then we would entertain that. Or the property was sold. But I'd rather go where she asked for it and we go that route. So she'll be contacting you. I told her I'd help her any way I can and we'll work through it. I know at one point we talked about the riparian ordinance and whether or not it was arbitrary or how we set the amount of feet from the middle of the stream. And I don't remember if that was in a small discussion I had or if it was a more broad discussion. Anybody remember that or no?
If I remember correctly, it was based on the distance from the library to the creek.
Yes.
When it first, so the, because it was existing, you know, all the existing structure that was there.
Yeah.
It had something to do with it.
It may have been that someone came up and talked to him about it just in visual, but... I guess there are different riparian setback ordinances throughout the state, but they vary in how big they go from the middle.
Generally, they go from 80 to anywhere from 80 to 300 feet.
Okay.
Ours is 125.
Yeah. So they had a question about that. How do we arrive at that number? And I wasn't sure. I said, well, I know after a lot of research and
there were other riparian acts in this whole area by Yellow Creek. If we took it out, that was the one that everybody knows we
issued. So rather than, you know, having an issue about the ordinance itself, I said I'd like to work with her on perhaps a variance to the ordinance about what they want to do with the property.
Anthony, how are you going to work with her? we got an ordinance for the center of the creek, 125 feet.
Well,
we're not going to make
Not to change the ordinance, Mr. Major.
Correct.
But to see what she wanted to do with the property and whether or not it's something that the variance board would entertain.
The Board of Zoning Appeals is going to.
Yeah.
So what if we go down that slippery slope, we're slipping down.
Anyway. As far as a variance for the repairing.
You can't deny a person the opportunity to request the variance.
You cannot deny it. I agree, but we can talk about it.
And then I made no promises, of course, other than I would help her through the process and work with her. So she's going to, I believe, contact Dave and or I, and we'll keep council apprised as to what they are thinking.
But then, in order to ask for a variance, there needs to be specifics, though, so that the Board of Zoning Appeals can...
Yeah, and they
just like, we would like to do, or maybe the new owner might like to do something.
Yes. Let me grab onto this. So... We won't deal in suppositives. In other words, first off, we're going to deal with the owner or someone who has a vested interest. In other words, a written option to buy with consideration. They need to have some skin in the game because we're not going to waste everybody's time. And then if they want to apply, they can apply. If we go to the Board of Zoning Appeals, the Board of Zoning Appeals will do what they see fit.
Exactly. Yeah.
So if any questions that she has, honestly, you should send them to me.
Okay.
I'll give her the straight man.
I'll be glad to.
Yeah. Honestly, you don't need to be doing
okay.
That.
I appreciate it. And other than that.
Okay, Dave, you didn't say anything about that letter from people in Delaware, Massachusetts.
Okay. I
just read it off
Hunter's
email.
Dave Hunter?
Yeah. I'll tell you what, we're in solicitor. Should we do that?
Yeah, you want to go back? You're done?
I'm done. Unless you want me to keep going.
No.
Okay.
Motion to approve the solicitor's report.
Oh, okay.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? We'll talk about this in new business, Steve.
Can I see you?
Yes. There's something that's on the back, too.
Okay.
Report from Chief of Police and Street Commissioner.
Play a lot of vacation, so I don't have a report.
Right here.
I'm here.
You couldn't miss the fun.
Do request an executive session to discuss personnel. Make it brief.
Tim Russ, is your report from engineer?
I have
reports from outstanding committees of council, finance, wage, audit, and insurance.
The only thing I'd like to tell you is that I did call the commissioner's office to ask about how long that meeting is going to take. Because as you recall, we had asked if Gary would come in before a public meeting prior to our regular scheduled meeting to talk about the levy, answer any questions that our residents would have. They said approximately an hour.
Yeah.
So how about we set it up with Gary for 6:30 if we need part of caucus to continue it, if we need to suspend orders even into the regular meeting, we can do that. But I'm thinking you want to get that over with early in October and not wait too long.
Yeah.
To answer questions, because people will start getting their ballots in the mail if they do it that way, absentee, so we don't want to miss anybody or not give them the opportunity to ask questions that they might have.
So you're talking about October 6th when Gary's coming in?
I have to call him to make sure, but is that good with everybody? So we would have the commissioner meeting here at 5 o'clock, 6:30 would be the public hearing, and then our regular meeting after that. Finance is working on the. I shouldn't say that.
That was finance, wage, audit, and insurance. I don't know if that was really a report, was it?
Yes.
Okay. Motion to approve the report.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Legislation and Policy Committee.
Nothing to report.
Police and Fire.
Nothing.
Street, Sidewalks, and Drainage.
Nothing. Mark has that.
Blooper.
Just one thing. I did contact Phil DeMatteis. Regarding the decorations, and we're on his calendar for the first week of November. And I drew up a contract and it's in a sum of $600, but there's a little gray area in there, depending on the repairs that might have to take place, replacement of any bulbs or strings or anything like that. So there might be an extra charge in case they have to do any repairs like that. So that's the way I drew up the contract. I just gave it to the solicitor to look at. You're okay with it? Okay. So the process should be for me to give the contract to the mayor to sign, or do I send it to him first to sign and send back? Because it's all going to be done probably electronically.
Just give me the information and I'll do it.
Okay, yeah. I'll give you the contract.
We should probably have a motion of council to enter that contract to see if that's the amount that's going to be.
Okay, but again, like I say, there's going to be.
Have that number?
Yeah. Okay. That's all I have.
Bill, they had mentioned about maybe they might ask for some additional lights, but that Paula Junior Women's Club would pick up the.
That's their, yeah, that's going to be their sponsor. With us taking requiring money for that tree, I didn't think we could go much beyond the $600 that we committed to. Maybe next year we can add.
Was that re-concluded? Did she say?
That was a one-time deal.
Oh, okay.
Make a motion to accept the issue report.
Second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Push some boards. Planning Commission.
Nothing.
Board of Zoning Appeals.
Nothing.
Architecture Review Board.
Nothing at this time.
Forest Board.
Hi. Do you want to say something, Elmer, about what we got from Tim and what you put together here?
Oh, you mean the document that
yep.
we shared this evening?
Yep.
The mayor provided to the village appointed forest board the topics that you see for each of those, I believe, seven categories. And those were from Mr. Bartlett from ODNR, from the Forestry Division. So the purpose of it was to determine what the position is regarding the Forest Board to those topics. We did have an interesting and exciting meeting, and this is a consensus, for the most part, of what the opinions were around the table and what our opinion is at this time. So I don't know if now this also gets your input from Village Council regarding your position on those seven topics. I don't know what your next step is, Mr. Mayor, but we did respond to the Mayor's request and thus to Mr. Bartlett through the Mayor. Do you have any questions?
Okay, did you intend each member of the council, of the committee, to submit a...
From the Forest Board?
Yeah, from the Forest Board.
Well, not each member. This is sort of a collective.
Okay, that's what we did.
Yeah.
We got together.
If everyone did their own, it'll be different.
Eleanor, here's what we had, right?
Yep, exactly.
And then this is the result.
Correct.
Okay.
And if you'll please note at the bottom, I did clarify that when the document was sent back to me, we had a scribe for the evening, that a member of the Forest Board did add the bracketed statement that you see at the bottom of the page under the timber section, number six. However, we had to move forward as a group on that particular statement. It doesn't mean everyone won't agree to it when we discuss it again, but it was added after and with good intent and good spirit, but wasn't part of that particular evening. I just wanted you to know that. There it is and how it arrived. Any question?
Well,
thank you.
I have to read it first.
But I don't, do you all feel that council needs to do this themselves, or the forest board as a representative of council, we should submit it as written?
Well, certainly one of the items about timber production, that's the whole thing that we've been talking about. I think the council should step up to the plate on that one. And do something. I mean, I don't think that's consensus of the council. And I think we shouldn't let something like this go with our blessing, that it doesn't really reflect what the village council feels about these.
The council should vote on this.
Absolutely.
Correct.
Well, so, I don't.
I thought we were going to work with the Division of Forestry.
We are. He just wants our thoughts on all these items.
So this is going to be presented to
him.
But this is the feelings of the Forest Board, not necessarily the feelings of, and he'll understand that this is necessarily the feelings of the council.
I think we should act independently and get our oar in the water too, because this will be taken as gospel.
All seven topics are there, so before next meeting, if everyone wants to, and I'll send out the email that I sent to you, Eleanor or whatever, so if everyone wants to do their own little thing before the next meeting.
I think we should discuss it at the next meeting, for sure.
Mr. Mayor, there's a problem with number six here. This actually is not the way that the money should be handled, and that is set forth in our original ordinance. Proceeds cannot go to the Poland Forest Foundation, which is a private organization. As a matter of fact, I think most people are not aware of that section of the ordinance and how it reads. That money is to be used only for the forest, and it is protected under the ordinance and the will as well. And
the deed.
Correct. That's right. Okay. And it also has to have a treasurer who takes care of the handling of that money. And when they come for audit, state auditors have to see those records and have to audit that just as they do any other public money. So it definitely cannot go to the Poland Forest Foundation, and it will be monitored. And you know, the thing that made me go back and look at this again is because when we listened to so many people come in and talk to us, so many people were hitting on this assumption that we would get the money, the village, and we would spend it however we please. And I realized that that is a big misunderstanding in the way that is written, that document. That money does not come to us to determine how it gets spent. It is actually all run by the Forest Board through the village. But it is
much like the Hine Fund.
Correct. Well, there is the Hine Fund Board basically that runs that. The village doesn't tell them you have to use the money this way or that way. We have to give final approval for the expenditures because that's policy.
Yeah, but money is released from the village to the Hine Fund for spending as the board sees fit. So basically, the money for the forest would be held by the village and released to the board, pretty much as they manage the forest.
Let me ask, where is he?
I crossed that last line out, so before 7:10. They might have meant forest,
Mr. Sharp.
Whatever, board of forest.
Where did you cross off?
The last line at number six.
Proceeds
should go to the Forest Foundation. That's not true.
Right. The Forest Foundation is a private entity, correct?
It's a 501c3.
Okay.
Which is a charitable organization under the IRS.
So I think that there's a lot of confusion that people think that we're going to take that money from the ash trees and spend it however we please. And that's not the case. I mean, that is to be used only for the forest, that money that comes
in. Any income gleaned from the forest has to go back into the forest.
Right.
And the fact that there is not an account already set up tells me that we've never taken money from the forest and put it back into the forest.
Right, because there's never been any revenue.
That's
the thing. All revenues have to be accounted for and expenditures. There's never been any revenues. The only thing they've ever had to spend is money that council gives them to spend.
Right. So we've got to set an account.
It's a county item.
Yeah, for the money that we hopefully will be getting.
So it will be protected.
Will this become a line item for giving? Will this become a line item in their budget?
I believe that it would, but I would want to be sure that we are doing it all correctly.
Don't we already have a line item?
Yes,
with the forest?
We have a line item.
We put in 250, I believe, this year or something like that.
If we have the money to give them. We show no revenues for them.
Right, yeah, there's no revenue side, there's just an expenditure side.
Okay, so are we on the right track here?
The board is responsible for receiving all money and keeping a record of all income received. The book shall be open, for the state auditors. Annual statements of income and expenses shall be issued by the board.
Oh, okay.
We don't handle this money. Not like the Heim Fund. The Heim Fund, we have handled that money. We get it in and we give it out for them. I believe this forest board will handle all of it.
How do they hand it? Where to handle it? Where do they put it?
What section are you under, Hank?
1062.04.
Does it need to be pulled in on our books? That might be a call to the state auditor's office we're going to have to make. Do we have to represent it on our books? If they're going to want to look at it when they come, and it says that specifically in the ordinance that we have that goes way back, that would be audited by the state auditors, then do we have to reflect it on our books as well?
1062.4.
Yeah.
So the Board of Commissioners of the Municipal Forest is the Forest Board, is that?
Yes.
This is open up a lot of questions that we never knew.
Because there never were any revenues to deal with. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Excuse me, Ellen Rosetic from Golden Manor. That was our reasoning, right or wrong. That was our impetus or encouragement to report that money would go, because we don't have a treasurer within the board itself, and I don't believe at this time we're set up to function in that manner, although it may be how we're supposed to, but we have to work on that as a group here. So that's why we designated, in our opinion, which you've now stricken from the number six, we felt that the Forest Foundation is set up to handle revenues dispersed only to the Forest Board. To my knowledge, they don't spend it anywhere else. So that was our reason for placing that particular statement. Thank you.
And I think what Ms. Edgar is saying falls in line with what the section says, because it says, the book shall show in detail every item of expense incurred, every item of income received by the Board of Commissioners. So whatever Poland Village gives to the Board of Commissioners, they then are tasked with expending and then accounting for on an annual statement to the Poland Village Council. It's very unnecessarily cumbersome, if you will. But what this is saying, essentially, and it goes with when the ordinance was created, giving the Forest Board the authority to manage the forest, that you then also have the money to do so, and trust to do so, but the money has to come from Poland Village. Understanding that the woods are designed to have the cycle of generating money through Poland Village to be given to the board to administer, and then to account for the village.
Are you reading that part of the ordinance where it talks about them setting up a treasurer who will make all receipts of revenue and all expenditures?
It says it'll be issued by the Board of Commissioners. The annual statement shall be and income expense will be issued by the Board of Commissioners. It doesn't say by the Treasury, so we see to you, Nick?
If you look up 1062.02, as the organization of the board.
Oh, I see it.
They shall have a chairperson, a vice chair, a secretary, and a treasurer.
Okay, again.
Such treasurer shall give an official bond in such amount as may be fixed by the board.
And then do you see a section in there that it will be audited by the state auditor's office when they come?
Yes. 1062.04.
So that's how you protect public money.
Mm-hmm.
So whatever we need to do, it can be done.
Yes. How this is able to go to enforce the foundation.
To do it.
Foundation.
And change to the fourth board there, Charles Rumberg's now the head of the foundation. So he's a younger guy and he's, you know, he knows what Poland's all about, so hopefully that will help us moving forward too. I know Mrs. Edgar's been talking with him a little bit, trying to get some direction.
But there is a rapport, right, between the two, the fourth board and the foundation.
May I respond?
Yes, you.
Was it all
as much as I'm out of order for asking?
Well, yes, thank you for the flexibility. It's appreciated. Because as I've shared with the mayor, Charles and I sat down Sunday and went over a lot of things, both the future of the Forest Foundation. He will be the next president of the foundation. And I felt that I, as chair of the Forest Board, that we should communicate. And there is rapport. In fact, I would anticipate a very good and understanding rapport with the entire Forest Foundation. As you know, there are a number of people on that board, and we have, I believe, 7 on the Forest Board. So we were very earnest in how we're dealing with the forest. It's just we've been encumbered for a number of reasons. Money, we've been trying to find out how we fit and where we fit correctly. So, but we have a punch list, not only the one that I had created in April of this year for the work to be done, and believe me, we've taken the street department and Russ off that list. We understand where we fit with this. But therefore, we need it paid for. The obvious thing to pay for a lot of the work would be any grace here as well as the foundation. It's not a bottomless pit with the foundation. That way we needed to look at all of the things that need done, and there are a lot of things. We also know that we need to come up with people who will do the work. Most people won't bid jobs there. They're very small jobs. And also, we hold to what I believe you hold to when you look for vendors to take care of things for the village. Anyone who does work for us must be insured, must have working men's comp. All of those things, and whatever you tell us in addition, if I'm missing something. So we understand that we need those things in place, and we have to pay for it. So I believe communication will be very good between your commissioners for the forest as well as the foundation. And we are having a meeting the 17th of September of both groups.
Do you know how much money the Poland Foundation has?
I've never seen a
budget. $100,000.
$135,000 or somewhere.
And they have never, the last few years, they haven't supported anything in the forest.
Well,
they have not given money for a dime.
Well,
so that's quite a foundation.
That
so
is,
it has to be loosened up.
That is going to change because I believe now that all of this has bubbled to the surface, we're all talking about it, we realize something has to be done. And
you have to get outside people to come in and help you and use the foundation money.
That's
what it's there for.
Yes, that is correct.
And you've been there 2 years now, it has to get going.
Well, I understand. I've been there just a little over a year and a half now, and I realize that I had to learn how all the parts worked. You would think, being married to Bob Zediker, I knew how all the parts worked, but he had his own umbrella of efficiency, and that was his bailiwick. I have my bailiwick as far as my community work. So I've had to learn the working parts. I've made mistakes about where to ask and who to ask, so I certainly take responsibility for that. It doesn't dilute the interest. Also, you have to please understand that there are a number of people, no matter which way we turn, they put up a roadblock. A verbal roadblock, nothing more than that. But it is very difficult. This is a small community, and we all have to live together and work together. So we're trying to move this forward. The process will work. It's beginning to fit together. And I realize your concern and discontent. We did have a very well-done letter, 3 pages, from a concerned citizen, and it was extremely articulate, and it did chastise the Forest Board. And rightly so. It was not brutal, but it was to the point. We are trying to move forward. We're not going to worry about the rearview mirror. We have to go forward, and we know that. So, do you have any questions?
Sounds great. We really appreciate that, what you're putting into this.
And we don't want to thank you for that. We don't want it to just sound great. We're trying to hold hands and move forward as a group. But I'm telling you, if somebody's not willing to move, you can leave, follow, or get off. If that's all there is to it. Okay?
We want to be sure that we are following everything that we need to follow as far as the ordinance goes and as far as compliance with the state auditor's office, obviously. Because we certainly don't want any citations and how the money is being handled. Anything like that.
I'm going to have to read this over a couple of times. I should have this all in order.
Forest Board. Oh, by the way, there's a, I don't know if you're aware, but a tree has fallen across the path at Bluebell Circle. I saw it this morning, just beyond the Mothy Bridge in the circle. And it's a pretty large tree, and people are climbing over it to go around.
I'll try to find a tree person.
Or can
they've got lots of work and they're not answering phones.
Does Russ cut those out sometimes?
Sometimes.
They must have just fallen last night or something. Okay, motion to approve the Forest Board report.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
High Memorial.
Nothing.
And Western Reserve Fire District.
Nothing.
Reports from special committees. Communications from residents. Any new business?
I have something. I actually received an email forwarded on to me from Paula. It was from a resident over on Massachusetts. They are talking about forming a community organization, something like a homeowners association, to consist of homes on Massachusetts and Delaware, to help combat the overall decline of their neighborhood. One of the things they talk about in the letter specifically would be cars parked on lawns. I think it's a great idea for them to band together. I think we saw a little while back what peer pressure can do when it comes to negligent homeowners. I think that is the most influential force in the community, even more so than going to court.
And what's that state? Michigan?
No, Massachusetts and Delaware.
Massachusetts and Delaware.
Any other new business? Any old business?
I have one thing. On this contract we got from Vicks.
Yeah.
I'm assuming that they're insured and have workers' comp.
Yes. Yes, we checked in that previously when they did this trenching over here.
Okay.
Although, now that contract might change, because I'm going to talk to him about taking this tree down as well.
Anthony, is that something that we should be getting all the time? Like, if he was here last year, we have to look.
Yes, he is on insurance.
His workers' comp.
If he's recurring, guy.
Yeah. Well,
I think annually, you just have it for our vendors.
Just make sure that we add that.
Okay. Hold off on the PO on that, though.
Okay.
Until I talk to him about this trip.
Well, this one's already issued.
Oh, okay.
For that, so it'll be a separate.
Okay, I'll have to do a separate PO.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, any other old business? Motions, ordinances, and resolutions.
I'd like to make a motion to waive the three readings, to pass by emergency, a resolution for a tax levy.
Second. Roll call. Chris should do roll call.
Oh, I'm sorry. Jennifer Meyer. Mr. Cassette is absent. Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Attorney Lemon?
Yes.
Mr. Major?
Yes.
Mrs. Cerner?
Yes.
And Mrs. Yash?
Yes.
I'd like to make a motion for a resolution correcting the previous clerical error in the prior resolution number 07-15 of the Village of Poland and clarifying the intent of the Village of Poland that the levy proposed by Council for the improvement and repair of the roads and streets of the Village of Poland commencing in 2016, first due in calendar year 2017, and to declare an emergency.
Second. Roll call.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Attorney Limmer?
Yes.
Mr. Major?
Yes.
Mrs. Cernick?
Yes.
Mrs. Yash?
Yes.
All right, any other motions, ordinances, or resolutions?
Yeah, make a motion to enter into a contract with Damateus Lawn and Landscaping for the amount of $600 for Christmas decorations, and also in the event that previously purchased decorations require repair or replacement, the contractor will notify the Village of Poland of the cost of repairs. Upon agreement of the additional cost, the contractor will proceed with the agreed services.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Other motions, ordinances, or resolutions? Second and third readings. Presentation of the bills.
Make a motion that the bills be paid.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Questions from the news media? Remarks by council, Mr. Donovan.
Wishing Councilman Cassette well in his recovery.
Mr. Major.
Same.
Mrs. Cerny.
Same. Wish Mark well.
Wish Mark well and would like to go into executive session for police personnel.
Second. Roll call.
Mr. Donovan?
Yes.
Attorney Limmer?
Yes.
Mr. Major?
Yes.
Mrs. Cerner?
Yes.
Mrs. Yash?
Yes.
8:25. So, okay, first.
Chris, thanks for taking the minutes.